What's up, guys? I'm Justin Ball, and welcome back to The Recording Percussionist, where I show you everything you need to know to get from that beginning stage of looking at a microphone or camera for the very first time to that intermediate stage where you feel confident in your ability to set up, record, and edit an entire recording session all on your own. If you've been keeping up with the series, we've talked about sound, how it's captured, microphones, and now it's time to talk about the next point in the audio recording timeline, which is the audio interface. I'll start by reviewing the basics of what it does, the various specifications they come with and what they mean, and which ones you need to look out for when purchasing one. The modern audio interface is confusing because of the presence of preamps and 48-volt phantom power. While both of these are commonly built into the physical audio interface, they should not be confused with the main responsibility of the interface, which is to convert the line-level signal into a digital signal and send it to and from the computer for processing. That being said, thinking of the audio face in layers can be somewhat helpful. On the outer layer, we have 48-volt phantom power, which sends power to condenser microphones as an electrical current through the XLR cable. Once the microphone has this power, it's able to capture and convert sound into a weak mic-level signal. This signal is sent from the microphone back through the XLR cable to the next layer of the interface, the preamp. The preamp amplifies this weak mic-level signal into a stronger line-level signal capable of processing. The level of this amplification, or gain, can be adjusted using knobs found next to the XLR inputs on the physical audio interface. From here, the freshly amplified signal enters the third layer, the audio interface, which then converts the line level signal to a digital signal and sends it to and from the computer for processing. Audio interfaces are pretty versatile in 2021, and as you begin your search for the right one, there are a number of specifications you'll want to consider. One of the first things most people look at when buying an interface is the type and number of input and output channels. For our purposes, we're recording with microphones, so we obviously want XLR inputs. The number of inputs depends on how many mics you intend to use at once. If you're planning on recording a percussion ensemble piece and feel like you need 8 microphones, you'll need an audio interface with at least 8 input channels. It's also helpful to make sure that the interface has just as many preamps as it does inputs. Without preamps, you'll need another way to adjust the input levels, and it's just so much easier when you can do it right there on the interface. The next thing you want to check is the type of computer connectivity. It's important to double check the specs on your computer to confirm the style of connector you'll need. If you find an interface that you really like, but for some strange reason the connector types don't match, just hop on Amazon and find the right kind of adapter you need beforehand so that you don't end up waiting several days before you're able to use it. If you're using condenser microphones, you'll want to make sure that the interface has 48-volt phantom power. Without it, the mics won't work, so it's like kinda important. The next thing you want to check for is latency, which is the amount of time it takes to get sound from the interface to your speakers or headphones. This is especially important if you're going to be using input monitoring, in which you're listening to the sound after it's been processed by your computer. The latency has to be low enough that you don't hear any phasing or lag between the sound created and what you hear through the speakers or headphones. While we're at it, most audio interfaces are also capable of something called direct monitoring, in which you're listening to the raw, unprocessed audio in real time directly from the interface, without ever going through the computer. What goes into the computer is the same as what you're hearing, you're just reducing the amount of time it takes by eliminating that extra distance. Next up is sample rate and bit rate. I made an entire video on this topic, but for now, sample rate tells us how accurate the capture of frequency information is, and bit rate tells us the same for amplitude. What you're looking for here is at least 24-bit conversion and 48 kHz sample rate or higher. To address the question of exactly which audio interface you should buy, if you're new to this stuff, you won't exactly be needing a maximum performance audio interface. Even entry-level interfaces have incredible capabilities in 2021, so as long as you check off the specs we talked about in this video, you should be okay. I typically advocate for the Focusrite Scarlett 3rd Gen and pre-Sonus interfaces, because those are what I have experience with. However, for the purpose of this video, I did some research and learned quite a bit more about some other brands. Rather than going through each of these individually, check the description for a link to some of the most popular audio interfaces in 2021, complete with specs, pricing, and links for those of you interested in learning more. If you'd like to learn how to set up your audio interface using Adobe Audition specifically, I've included two additional videos where I show you how to do this on both Windows 10 and Mac. If not, then move on to the next video where we dive into sample rate and bit depth. Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed it, and if you're learning as much as I am from this series, consider subscribing. And until next time, happy recording.